So it's been there. So technology, we are in such a world, like we started luckily in 1999, where we were trained on design patterns, object-oriented analysis and design, Java 1.2, 1.4, and JavaScript was naive, and client-side validation, Ajax was new, and we all knew was XML, XSLT, and if you can do XML, transform that on browser, HTML gets generated, you are thrilled about it. Go to interview question, they say XML, what is DOM parser, what is SAX parser? That's the first set of interview questions that we get it. No, XML is nowhere, right? So now everyone talks about JSON, JavaScript, everywhere JavaScript. Now Python, JavaScript are competing between each other. So I was loyal to Java. So even though they give projects something on .NET or something, I will use something or the other in Java. And statically typed, I was started in Emacs editor, then moved to Eclipse. And then without that IntelliSense that is working, I don't want to write any code. That's how I became handicapped. And then JavaScript came, and everyone started to move to HTML5 JavaScript, and I was stuck with Eclipse editor with IntelliSense, and all these JavaScript guys and Python guys were opening a notepad and then started coding fast. So I was like, oh man, I was like from Emacs to Eclipse, and now I'm handicapped. How do I write to JavaScript code? So 2010, I think the Hasgeek started, and then HTML5 conference was there. I was like a JavaScript learner, only written client-side validation. I went to Kiran and then said, what editor do you use? You know, I don't know, Notepad is a little scary for me and all that stuff. So they said, Notepad, I'm fine, Notepad, Emacs and all that stuff. So JavaScript, there is no clear API documentation, right? At least Java, you can open the API documentation, you know the method contract, you know this is, so what I know is W3 schools. No one told me about Mozilla Developer Network, which is the, nowadays I tell Mozilla Developer Network, don't go through anything, tutorials point, W3 schools, everyone start doing it, and then Mozilla Developer Network, they kind of forget it. So that's how it started. But now with Oracle acquiring Java and all the changes that are happening to Java, I'm now very loyal to JavaScript. Now JavaScript, they are starting to put TypeScript and all the Java players they're bringing into JavaScript, I hate it. So I normally, like, I stick on to Angular 1 as well. So Angular, because Angular 6 is statically typed, we put TypeScript and all Java constructs and other things, I'm seeing it. So we are happy with JavaScript, the original JavaScript, the original AngularJS, because it is dynamically typed and it's free of thought and you can churn out code faster. Only thing is, suddenly core dumped will come, but that is hidden by PM2, that's what I'll be showing it through. So no core dump to the user, but in between you can see the error logs in the backend file that so many times it is crashed. Why unreferenced variable? Some comma is missing, some spelling mistake is there. So those kind of things are there, the problems, but we are living with it. So with that, I'll just explain to you like how JavaScript, I'm convinced that such a JavaScript can be used to think big in JavaScript. In Java, we are actually building enterprise applications. So be it for stock exchanges, like a backend complete settlement system is all in Java with all the integrations and web services that are there. You've got enterprise application server. So their whole thing is matured enough to handle all the components and framework that are there for enterprises. So now JavaScript is all open. You just go and search for JavaScript framework, you get hell a lot of things. Sorry to use that. Okay, so now, so increased tooling, so that's what I could see it from 2010. Now, I got to see all the tools that are there, that were there for Java is also there here. We are using Maven for build automation. You have a handful of build automation tools that are there. You got unit testing, they are JUnit and all the JUnit, Mockito and all that stuff. But here you get complete set of tools with all the Mocha, Chai framework, Karma, Protractor and all the stuff on the UI. So complete stack can be test automated. So I got all the tooling support, the Jenkins support JavaScript based continuous integration. So I can create a Docker image out of the JavaScript based application that is there. So I got a complete tooling support, then why not have a complete enterprise application built on JavaScript? So we need to see not just apps and tools on JavaScript, but we would like to have high grade or highly scalable, extensible, enterprise grade application that should be built in JavaScript. That's what my advice to all the JavaScript community out here. Frameworks. You have got all open source stuff, you can assemble everything, more richer language features, object oriented and functional programming. We play around with it right now, so you have functions, you pass it around, callback functions, event callbacks, So, and then the object-oriented stuff too, to make it modular and reusable. So I could mix Java and functional programming and then get all the stuff. Java 8 introduced functional programming. I'm not questioning or debating about my good old friend. But yes, JavaScript is there with rich language features that are there. And more reliable, better programming, server-side middleware has come now. So yeah, if you want that error handling and exception handling, you have to follow certain best practices. You can embrace TypeScript if you wanted to get into more reliable server-side code. But yes, you can support both the conventional JavaScript as well as the TypeScript wherever the critical pieces are there, where you want to, as he mentioned, defensive programming. So either use defensive programming or go to TypeScript where it is more structured and schema-driven stuff. So with this, so one of the things that the challenges we had was the development team was pretty much freshers, right? And it was 1 year, 2 year old. And we had to have training for them to build enterprise application. So if I start with Java, then I had to train one on middleware, one on the front end, one on the back end. So, but now when we choose a JavaScript stack, so it's one single technology. And no one is going to take over it, I think, because the web rules that. So it's going to be as a business perspective. So you can go and bet on JavaScript and build the expertise and the team around that, and then have your complete stack on one single technology. Now I have a team who can juggle between layers. You can work on front end once, you can work on back end, you can work on integration layer. You can also work on the mobile stuff, which I'll also kind of highlight and introduce to you. So all on one single technology and then training. And now ours is mostly like a student internship crowd that get converted into an employment. So it's something like where the students also can be taught. But nowadays, if you see it, most of the students which I interact with are dealt with C# and Java and Python. They look at JavaScript like something like mundane stuff where only HTML, JavaScript. They don't relate to a JavaScript as a server-side kind of a framework. They just look like website, PHP, JavaScript. That's all they think about in JavaScript. So I would expect them to think more big, bigger stuff, do bigger stuff in JavaScript. So before I go into this kind of a presentation where I'll be highlighting an enterprise-grade application and the architecture which I kind of put there, it is kind of correlated. We can draw an analogy between this enterprise application to any other enterprise application. The overall approach towards building an architecture and solving it, it remains the same. So what we have done is, so we, a higher education institution has got these distinct functions, right? You have to work with an education institutions to have a feeling for it. I was working in mostly a corporate till 18 years, the last 2.5 years with education institutions closely. The departments and committees are all very well structured and well bordered as well. They wanted that kind of a control to their department. An admissions department don't, they want the complete control of data. They want the complete control of processes. They want the complete control of any innovation that comes to the process as well. So similarly, you have got students management, curriculum design, faculty, staff management, and so on, fees collection, academic administration, examination, placements, events, grievance, alumni hostels, the list goes on and on. And when you build solutions for that, everyone asks me, the senior management asks me, when are you going to go to market? I'll complete this module, that module. They say that, no way, it's going to go on forever. And then that's, so then we need an architecture which needs to be extensible. At the same time, integrated as well, right? So we need to have such an architecture which is going to be extensible, scalable, and it should have peak loads, because all these modules have got certain peak loads where students only they pay the fees in the last minute, right? Admissions and applications, they buy it only when the results are announced at that particular point of time, right? And then you have got examination, the uploading of marks happened during the last day by all the faculty for all the students. And then you have data which is cut across academic years and years of students' data, attendance data, the behavior data, the events that they have kind of conducted. You should ask the security of an education institution how many events they conduct, because they lock the rooms and unlock the rooms. They say that only 10 days the rooms are free, excluding Diwali and other Sankranti and all that stuff. So every day there are events happening from every department and program. All these data has to be collected, and that has to be used across academic years for mining the information that is there. So then finally they need website, which needs to be latest, trendy, and all that stuff, plus all the information that is happening inside has to be reflecting in the website as well. So the complete solution, there is no PHP there. People said website PHP and all the PHP framework. We said no, we wanted again Node.js and Handlebar.js to be the backend template, and then the frontend is simple jQuery and other plugins that are there. So it's also Node.js, including the internal automations plus the external website is all driven by Node.js server, and around 15 microservices and plus the website which is going to be running on the Node.js server. And with only one machine till now, because it's a very predictable load, you know how much the user base is, right? It's 12,000 odd students and 1,000 odd faculty. And so that is the user base that you're going to cater to. So 32 GB machine, one single commodity server, 1 lakh rupee, that is all that is required. And people from other cloud vendors like Amazon, Azure, tried to kind of tell education institutions to buy their solutions and all that stuff to get kind of dependent on that particular platform. There's a recurring cost that is involved, right? So you need to pay them every other day, but they get grants. So why not put a commodity server? If it has to be scaled, only during those things, you just scale the microservice vertically and horizontally and spin off another instance and then do it at that particular spike load. So rather than actually having a heavy server and then investing too much on that. So it's well-defined, clear ownership of data, predictable peak average workload that are there. So you can play around with the environment, deployment environment. So when the workload is there, the admissions is done, the admissions microservice doesn't require such a footprint, correct? So a fees collection, only when those fees due date comes in, you can only have that particular higher end instance for fees collection, right? So we need that kind of a scale up and scale down kind of a mechanism in the overall architecture, but that should be independent of other functions, right? A student management is something that cut across all the timeline. So it's going to be like, it's going to be a constant load, but whereas the other modules will be having a peak load and an average load or a downtime through which you can optimize your architecture, right? So again, we have to cater to multiple education institutions. So engineering educations, arts and science, you've got medical college, you've got pharmacy, polytechnic, there are different varieties of higher education institution. Every other institution have their own schema, especially when it comes to student or curriculum or faculty and so on. So you need to have a kind of schema-less stuff. And now with UI framework that are coming, you can build a dynamic UI, right? But the only thing that we wanted to avoid is a relational model for it. So just because, you know, you'll keep on doing relational model again and again and normalizing it. So we tend to go with a non-relational data model for it. Loosely coupled, because every other module has got a huge roadmap. Like for example, placements has got a huge roadmap. So I should be able to have a dev team which is independent of other modules so that they can kind of innovate and then build modules or feature set on top of every module that is there. So admissions is again another one. Right? There are startup companies which are focused on admissions application. There are startups which are focused only on placement. Right? But now what we are trying to do is one single product suit which on JavaScript and everything is kind of isolated and independent but yet integrated, and I'll talk about how we have integrated. So we can talk about RabbitMQ or API based integration and distributed deployment, right? Sometimes they would like to say some of the modules can be on public, some of the modules have to be local, right? For example, events can be on public, and then some of the modules like curriculum and other stuff, they don't want to make it public. Because some of the things are intellectual property as well, how the program curriculum is being designed. So an architecture which should be an agnostic in terms of deployment is also very necessary. So in terms of it, so some of the peak loads, if you are not able to handle it in our server, we can move that to a cloud or AWS or an instance on AWS or Azure, and then have that running on the cloud, remaining thing can be running on premise. So we should have a deployment environment which can scale and then be cloud agnostic as well. So that should not be manual, and that should be an automated deployment that should happen. That's why we have leveraged Jenkins and Docker and then went ahead with the continuous delivery pipeline that is there, right? Another thing is education institutions are very concerned about recurring cost, right? Your total cost of ownership should be very less. So you can't have a licensing cost that is going to come. As much money that they give, you should try to get that, right? Rather than giving it to some other software, right? So you that is one of the reasons where everything is open source out here. So rapid prototyping, and when you are, your customers are scholars and professors, it's very difficult to convince them because they are teachers, right? They are always right. Customers are always right, But you have someone who are scholars, when they say that, okay, when you go as a vendor or service provider, you are a student to them, right? So they say that, okay, do this and do that stuff and I need it tomorrow. Okay, it's like an assignment giving it to you. Okay, sir, we'll do it. So now we get a rapid prototyping, something we'll do Jugaad inside. So, and then say, download PDF, get a PDF there, whether it's from the file system or whether it is from the, it depends on the time, right? So, but yes, so you have to work with something which is rapid as well as fast prototyping that is required for them to see it in short. We can't talk technology to them. They are scholars in their own disciplines. You can't go and then say, I'm microservices, this is API driven, this is REST and that is GraphQL and all that stuff. They say that, what is all that stuff? Talk in my language, right? I want this screen, I want this report. Tomorrow I want it, send it to some university. They have asked me to submit it. That's it. So single sign-on across function, they don't remember their username and password. Remember, right? They keep their username, password same. And then, because they are not computer savvy, because I work with these kind of education institutions where they are very much into still the registers, still the forms, paper driven, manual driven, but they're very meticulous about it. They write it so neatly. Software and it goes and then kind of renders a complete user experience, UI, UX guy designed it. They say that my register is perfectly, see this, I use the scale, I drawn all the margins, and then I put all the title, the A3 size, double the A3 size, and then they maintain it. Now get me the report in your this small screen, it should be responsive in mobile also. Say, and yeah, such kind of stuff. So, so these are few challenges, but and another thing is deadlines are real deadlines. When you're working with corporates, so your deadline is like, okay, sir, this is not working. Your QA is doing the testing and the testing, certain bugs have come. So we'll postpone it to some two, three things. The critical bugs are there, system will fail otherwise, it will crash. So they say, that, okay, a stable system is very essential. Please go and then release it after two, 3 days. But here it is like fees. All the students have to pay it on the 10th of, say, January. So your system has to be up and running. They'll say, in my years, one particular student was sitting in a wrong, like software was generating it in a wrong room. In my 52 or 25 years of career, never ever I have had this kind of a scenario. First time when I put this software, I got this scenario. So, so they are so meticulous about it. So you can't make mistakes. It should be, they expect an error-free software, which is really ideal. And then it should be delivered on time before 5 o'clock in the evening. I have never released software before sunset. To be very frank, I have woken up QA guy at 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock in the morning. Hey, come on, test my software and then release it. Because according to the process, the QA guy has to do a manual testing and then only has to be released. So that kind of a process was there. So we were always having this, all this 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock releases, but this is one thing that is there. So now coming back to design principles, right? So even though you got a lot of frameworks, because we were born and brought up with certain fundamentals and foundations that embraced application design. And I really use that whenever you go and then build any other fancy stuff too. This can be the single responsibility principle, even though it's for object orientation, class design and all that stuff. You can define it and abstract it in such a way that is applicable to architecture also at all levels. So inversion of control, dependency injection, interface over implementation. The fundamental principles which we have applied in our overall architecture. And microservice, because it's highly maintainable, testable, loosely coupled, there's something attractive that is coming in. Excuse me, something really attractive. Really, really, wait. This all startup, I have certain starting trouble, but yes, afterwards we'll, when it JavaScript comes in, I'll really, it is, yeah. So, loosely coupled, independently deployable, organized around business capabilities. Because here, I don't have a bandwidth, I don't have a reason to go to senior management, to go and say my architecture doesn't work and I need to go and then redo the stuff. They don't appreciate at all. So I need to be cautious, at the same time need to be risk taking as well. So we said our overall architecture, I can't change my pillars so and so forth, right? I can change framework. Today I can put Angular, tomorrow I can put React or Vue or whatever it is, but my foundation should not change, right? Then these are the basic principles that one has to use it. So when an architecture has to be first brought in. So yes, now comes JavaScript plus microservice. Because we, as a solution architect, we don't want to give solutions which whatever we know, right? We are not doing justice to what the problem domain is. So you need to be convinced that your technology is going to really solve the problem and it is like a jigsaw puzzle where you assemble it and then keep it, it should be perfect, right? And so I'm convinced after seeing it working and seeing it, you know, extending into multiple other modules, that JavaScript plus microservices can do wonders for enterprise-grade applications as well, because the overall approach is divide and conquer, right? For any problem-solving technique, divide and conquer works a lot, right? Even if you wanted to climb up too many things, you want to climb up step by step, isn't it? So a JavaScript and microservice will enable you to build all this stuff. So I will be going through a typical microservice. Front end, I'm not going to touch that because it's very debatable. Someone will say Angular, someone will say Vue, someone will say React, someone will say vanilla JavaScript, right? So I'm not going to touch that. You use any framework that is there, because at the end of it, it should be a good UX, responsive design, mobile first design, and nice colors as customer pleases and whatever it is. Give themes so that they can choose their own colors, right? So, but I will stick to the backend, predominantly a backend service. We have chosen MongoDB, Express, and Angular, and Node.js. So this is our foundation for every microservice. This is the stack, right? The UI alone changes, right? Because the framework version keeps changing. The UI, sometimes material design, someone will say that we'll put material design. For some modules, because the audience is different. For events, it should be jazzy. For admissions, it should be something else. For a particular curriculum, it should be something else because the target audience is different, right? So maybe the UI and other things will change, but the foundation still is MongoDB, Express, Angular, and Node.js, and we are happy with it. So we are using MongoDB native driver because we are not using Mongoose, because Mongoose is again a schema driven. It does validation and verification, but when you have your complete backend, then you have got an application layer. If no one touches the backend data directly, very ideal, isn't it? So you'll always go to database and then chain the data and then say, okay, it's working. But yes, if no one touches it, then your whole validation verification can happen on client side and server business logic. So you can do away with the Mongoose validation that happened. So our DAO layer code is nothing. You have one single code and then that works for all the collections. So you don't have to keep writing all the CRUD and other aggregate queries for every collection that is there. You reuse across all the microservices. So our service side code is the most simplest thing, right? You have to put an API, put some business logic that is there, and then have your DAO layer which doesn't change, copy paste, right? I've shared all those things in the Hasgeek as in the GitHub as well. I'll give you the link for it. So and then I'll go through a few things. So I'll have so this is the DAO layer. My laptop. Oh, to zoom in Apple. Thank you. Windows is a good one, but I'm keeping it even though it is dead. I am just keeping it, you know, for moral boost. You know? And thanks to Atishay for lending me his laptop. So this is a simple one, but we have used closures here. So you just have to have this particular class, and whoever wants to use it can pass the collection name. Okay, I don't have this. My God, to catch it. Fine. So this is all the CRUD operation. So it uses something called get collection name. So you get the closure collection name. So whoever wants to use it, so you can. Okay. So this is only the closure. All the CRUD methods are there. If any DAO layer wants to use it, so you go back and to the DAO. And just one single DAO. So you just pass the collection name, all the CRUD operations are there, right? So this is our DAO layer or backend layer. So, and then we also use GridFS. So you can go to, currently we are storing all the binary data or attachments out here. And so it's a once download attachment or upload attachment. And then you have got the attachment ID, you put that one, and then you have the REST API for downloading and uploading any attachment. So there's no need to write repeated codes for attachments at all. So we use DropZone and for the frontend as a plugin. So it's again reusable across all the layers. Wherever you want attachments, you just put this code, it's going to work. So this is also shared, you can have a look at it.
I need to, sorry.
What is alt tab equivalent in, I'm making it interactive like this. So what is alt tab equivalent in Apple? There's no alt, no? I used to mouse and keyboard. Okay, fine. We as developers are used to alt tab, control alt del. These are the two keys that we use it. Now he is telling shake it. Okay, let me try it in the next slide. But yes, so our DAO layer, because we used generics in Java, so like you saw JPA and other stuff. So you pass the entity, which is relational entity, and then the primary key data type, so that the complete set of CRUD operations and DAO is kind of automated, right? Because you need a primary key type, because get find by primary key is one thing, and then you have to have the type of your entity class that need to be passed, so that all the CRUD operations can take an entity and do it. In Java, we just pass the closure, and then MongoDB was happy to take it. The next thing is, whenever we give project, the first two screens that initially people are creating is login screen and user screen, user management, and that itself will run for 2 months. Right, the project will start when the project is going to end for an intern. So then, luckily, unfortunately, with all the OAuth and other stuff come in, KeyCloak, I should have KeyCloak, namaste to it. It's doing wonders for us. So why I'm telling is because you just don't need to build any user authentication screen at all. Very, very simple. I'll kind of have a few screenshots that's also shared with in the GitHub. So every microservice is a KeyCloak client and running on different ports. So what KeyCloak expects is something like a URL, which is the base URL for every client, and you can specify client specific authentications that are required. You can also specify client specific roles that you want, and then you have users associated with the groups and groups to the roles. The login screen can be themed, so it doesn't look like a KeyCloak at all. Like it is your brand, you can put it, and then the login screen is really nice. It doesn't look like your other third-party provider, which has that other traditional legacy login screen, which you find it difficult. It uses free market template for creating your login theme, and then it is really nice. So we use one user realm. So if you want multiple institution, you can also have hierarchical realm as well. Right? You can have multiple realms for each institution. They have got support for even an hierarchical realm or multi-tenant architecture also for the realm. So, for example, you have got education institution 1, 2, 3, all belong to the same management. You can also have different realms for each institution and have a multi-tenant that will work for all these people. And they expose a REST API, so you can create a user on the fly. So, you have a user which is created by the respective modules. You have roles that are changed. So, you have a REST API through which you can go and then contact the API and then create the user, remove the user, disable all the stuff. So students discontinuing, going out, coming in, faculty getting added, all the stuff, and then faculty moving from one department to another department, the role getting changed, all those things are integrated with the system with KeyCloak as an API. KeyCloak also gives a JavaScript adapter, both on the client side as well as on the server side. So we can put a client side authentication, we use Angular KeyCloak and then tied on with the client side token based authentication, and we also use KeyCloak server side API to go and then have your middleware authenticating the user who is there. So no need to build user screen at all. So these are the initial friction that we had. We removed it by using KeyCloak, and let me share. No. Fine, let me do my conventional stuff of escape button and yeah, good. So now yeah, thanks. So now if you go to So now this is the all the topics that I have got. Everything has got the presentation slide and the other stuff. So you can go to OAuth using KeyCloak, and you got certain. So you got login theme. So you can set your own login theme. So you can go and create your own themes, and then you can attach it to a particular realm. So each realm you can specify what is the login theme that is there. So advantage is you can't access any of the application without logging in, right? So you don't have to worry about click on this, check whether it's authenticated or not and all that stuff. You don't have to worry about it at all. You just have to put this particular plugin on the front end, and it will take care of ensuring whether the token is there alive or not. Otherwise it will automatically redirect to the login screen and get it there. So this is one thing, and so one is the theme part. Then you have got client list. So for every microservice, you have got, you can see that this is the list of clients that are there for every microservice, and for each client, you have got the client specific client settings that are there. This is something important where you can have client specific roles, and then you can say for this particular module, this particular group has got these roles. So you can associate them. So you can go and control the authentication and authorization at every module level. So you don't have to write any piece of code for it. So all these things are there. Only thing that you do is hide and show in the UI if you want it, or in the backend, you can go and then check what roles are there for the logged in user. You are done with it. So, okay. So I'll leave it to you. You can go through them, and one of the things that I also have shared is the code fragment, which is there on the client side. So what we do is, we don't bootstrap Angular on the upfront. We first go to KeyCloak, authenticate everything, and then create that particular authentication tokens, everything into a separate module out there. And again, then use this particular module as a dependency into the application module that is there. So it gives you certain callback mechanisms for login when the token is expired, when the token is kind of refreshed and so on. So you can, here you can see it on auth success, where then you go and then bootstrap your module. So you can go and then bootstrap it, and so this is when you say angular element.ready. You go and then say angular.bootstrap with that particular document. By that time, the module is also initialized with the token and you'll be able to use it. So this is what we do on the client side. So this is how we have integrated the KeyCloak with the Angular part. And that's it. So no need to worry about any other login screen. You just have to pass certain credentials, what user realm you wanted to connect to, and what is the IP address in which the KeyCloak is running. Only these two things are essential. So what is the client? So which is accessing the KeyCloak? What is the user realm or repository to which you wanted to get it authenticated? What is the IP address of your KeyCloak server? These are the three configuration settings that we wanted to provide. And on the server side, you got the HTTP request. So I got admin client, so you can have create user code and all the stuff that is present out here. We are using REST API of your KeyCloak. And then we have got users to group association, and finally you have got so this is the one where you want to verify a request. You send it through auth headers in your HTTP request as a header that is there, and then you go to auth header and then check whether the token is pretty much valid or not. So a security expert out here might kind of go and then scrutinize it. It is serving our purpose because no student is going to hack our software right now. But yes, we will look into it by getting into OAuth standards and all this stuff. But this is working for us, and on the server side aspect. So if, whether it's for authentication or authorization to check if the role is present for accessing the service or API, we use depend on KeyCloak and the middleware to do it for us. So now, so this is one thing. And the next thing is, so the, now coming to integration, we have got all the modules and microservices that are there, but we need an integrated system that is needs to be present. So I hope everyone are aware of REST client inside your server side code. So if you want a synchronous call, when you say synchronous integration, I wanted a result upfront. Like as soon as I make a call, I want the result so that I will be able to process my business logic. We use an API integration, use a plain traditional REST client, Node REST client, and then connect to the API and then get it. We pass the same auth header which we receive for our request and then send it to the other microservice. So the same auth header is being shared between microservice through the server and we are able to integrate via the API. So this is one kind of integration. But when you want to have batch jobs which can run at the end of it and then you want to communicate between these service, we use something like a client ID or API key. So it's something like one secured key which you can generate for every microservice. So you authenticate based on the API key that you need to do. Another thing which we are fond of from a Java perspective is having an enterprise service bus. On in microservice, it's like an event bus. So you divided everything, but you need to kind of unite them and integrate them, right? So you need to have event bus. So because you have got two types of integration, one is point to point on PubSub. Point to point is something where I wanted to specifically tell that this particular student is dropped out, you wanted to change it something else. Or a particular fees collection has happened and you wanted to go and update certain thing. Or I change a particular who is going to be kind of resigned or inactive. So I need to have both point to point, which is like a queue, and PubSub, which is like a topic. So these two, the kind of integration mechanism is very well required to make it loosely coupled. Right, tomorrow I can plug in any module and then put it into PubSub. So everyone kind of gets to know about that event. Because the moment a student is deactivated or debarred because of malpractice, he should not be accessing any other system that is there. Right? I divided all the microservice, but I should not allow him to log in. I should not make him access any other features that is present. And I should ensure that he doesn't figure in any of the reports. One student, if it comes in, it gets escalated to principal and senior management. You are answerable. They'll say that I don't want to use the software at all. I'll go to the register system. So this, right? So you should be very, very, though you have the luxury of dividing into multiple microservice, but it should be integrated and the status of every entity should be maintained across it. And messaging system, the event bus is not running. That means you have to kind of other modules should not work. It's like your heartbeat that is going to be there. So we have used RabbitMQ and we have also put event gateway, a generic framework on top of RabbitMQ so that as an application layer, you don't have to worry about too much of bookkeeping stuff. So right now you can go and check this NPM repository and so there is a particular code. I have also placed the same thing in the GitHub as well. So now I'll just give you a glimpse of what a sender, a receiver will do, right? So what time? I have 9 minutes. Okay. So messaging. So you got this event gateway PSD. This is the module that we have developed as an adapter to communicate with RabbitMQ. It's pretty simple working on event emitter or logic that is present out there. So send event is like a point to point. So you want to send an event. So you kind of create a particular message, an event, and then send it to the MQ. So that queue will go to, will be listened by only a particular, only one can consume that event. It's not like multiple, it's not like a broadcast. So when you send an event, it's going to be processed or consumed by only one person. It's like a first come, first serve. If multiple people is listening on the queue, whoever is going to consume that message is going to take it and then consume it. So this is send event. So this is what a RabbitMQ part of assert queue and send to queue that is present out there. Publish event is like PubSub kind of a thing where you publish a particular event. Whoever is subscribed to it can go and then get that particular event. So it's like a one to many. If one microservice is publishing something, I want other microservices to go and then listen to it and then consume that and then put some bookkeeping to have it. We have compromised normalization. So there is redundant data across microservices. We don't want, just because I wanted, I have an ID student role number, I want to go and get his name and other branch and other stuff. I don't want to do a call. So there are certain common information, frequently accessed information we have replicated in other microservices. So we don't go in for other microservice for every other detail. We compromise that because you have the code application layer, so you can control what goes in, what goes out. So we have compromised redundancy. Normalization for performance and other integration issues that are there. So then we have got receive event, and all these things are generic. You don't have to write anything, right? These are all there. So subscribed event. So as a subscriber, you are subscribing to it. So what will it do is it will emit the event. So once you subscribe something and then event comes in from the message queue, it emits that event and your application code can listen on that event and then go and then do the process, right? So this is the library that you can use it. And as a sender, I will just show you what it requires from a sender perspective. Sometimes when you're working in dev mode, you might not work in an integrated mode, right? You can disable and enable AMQP so that you don't have to run always in integrated mode. So you can disable that as well. So this is our adapter. So we import that particular library. The only thing that we require is nothing but the URL in which the MQ is running, and then what events you publish, what events you receive, right? That's it. So you don't, and you get corresponding event callback that is going to be there, right? Because it's all string based. The emitter is just the string based thing. On a particular event, I'm going to get a particular callback. So here if you see it, event gateway on import enrollment, right? Or selection changed. So I am going to get an event from, say, dropped out. From some other module, someone is dropped out. I get that event. Now I go and then say that a dropped out message has come or event has come. So what do? I go and emit it internally to my microservice, and internally I will go and then handle this particular event, consume all the message that comes in. Only challenge that we faced is what kind of model or data model that is going to come in the event. So that is something which you document it and exchange it. So in that way it is going to be there. But in Java, you will have a Java class, you go into it and then you'll be able to find it out. But if you make it more type specific or TypeScript, you can go and then look at the structure of that particular event. So this is what a sender perspective, where I will go and then say emit it, or as a receiver, I go and then consume that and then publish it internally. So this is a piece of code that you have to write when you're working with a RabbitMQ. But this is what we have used to integrate it asynchronously. You don't have to be bothered about whether other microservice is running or not, right? You can bring it down, and then the message will be relying on the residing on the queue. And then when the message microservice comes up, the message gets delivered. So for synchronous, we use REST API call. For asynchronous, we are using this kind of an event-based leveraging RabbitMQ. The performance is very good. So you can have thousands of messages if it is unreliable, in the sense no persistent. But if you want a reliable queue, it's around 300, 500 messages per second. So you can send them and you will be able to do it. There is RabbitMQ comes with a monitor also. So you can have a console, go there and then find out what kind of messages have been received, what is still getting clocked. So you'll be able to set that up and then do it. So this is what we have used for integration. And next thing is about logging. So this is something where every other freshers or junior developers have to get groomed. So they should use logging effectively, right? Because log files can be used for analysis. It can also be used for diagnosis as well. Because when it is running in production server, you definitely require logging. So we have used logging, but logging not just one log file, but we have divided into different log files for different configurations for different set of use cases. When you are sending an SMS or an email, it's a different log file, because we would like to say whether SMS is gone or not, but it will be mostly bulk, and at that time we don't want it to get clogged with the other log files that are there. So we have used logs. So you can have a logging configuration. I think we have used rollback, rolling log stream, and then stream based logging that are there. So the configuration is given again in the GitHub that is being shared. So you can have a look at it. And so that is one thing. And very essential is PM2, which hides the crashes which we have made, or because we like, it's been 2 years, we have to build all these modules, 1.5 years, all the modules, and it should be up and running. So we worked and built the modules parallel to the deadlines that are there, so that we build fast. So in that rush, there are a few code dumped also that has happened. So all those things you'll be able to get it from the PM2 log, right? We have something like, you can go and check out this link. So we switch between customers based on an environment variable. The corresponding configuration file and the setup files get changed based on the environment variable. So you can go and then use ecosystem.config.js. So if you have used that, only a few minutes. just a couple of things. So okay, so this is the file where we go and then specify what is the environment variable, what is the microservice that you wanted to access, and what is the port number in which it is going to run. So everything is configured out here, and then PM2 does the remaining stuff. So PM2 has got much more capabilities. You can have process management, you can have clustering and all that stuff, so you don't have to bother your Nginx. The same port it will run, and it will leverage the Node.js cluster, and then have your throughput based on the number of cores of CPU that is present in your system. So leverage PM2 as much as possible. The link that I have shared is going to give you all the details about PM2. The finally, you, at the end of it, you wanted to assemble them, and then for the end users, it shouldn't look like a microservice is running the whole stuff, right? So that is where your Nginx comes into play. So okay, so we are using HTTPS, and then Nginx is used as your SSL terminator. So inside everything, all the microservice, everything is HTTP. So only the front end part is the Nginx, where the SSL is going to be, certificates are registered, and HTTPS is going to get connected. It also acts as reverse proxy, so that you don't have static files which are downloaded by every other client. So all the common JavaScript files, library files, and backend, all the themes and everything, it's going to be served through the Nginx that acts as a reverse proxy. And then this is the one where I'll just show you the, at the end of it, I'll show all the stuff. So Nginx has got a config. I'll just show you how all the microservices are put in the Nginx sites available config file. I'll also show a walkthrough a Jenkins file, how we have had a Jenkins pipeline for all the microservices, so that everything is automated right from your deployment build to the deployment. We have not automated the unit testing yet, but it will be done. So that is there. So Docker is the Jenkins pipeline, takes care of Docker image also being created. So we get a Docker image at the end of it. MongoDB is kept in a separate Docker image. And then all the other microservice code will be kept in the other Docker images that are there. So at the end of it, what you get is nothing but a working Docker image that is there. The things to be explored are Kubernetes or Docker Swarm, so through which you can have the Docker images going through the other parts of it as well. So other thing is, one thing that we really rely on is PDF. Whatever we do in the software, at the end of it, they require a PDF report which can be printed and then filed. Right, and all the fancy reports that I mentioned has to be appearing in the same way in the PDF as well. Right, so subscripts are subscripts. So you have got syllabus book that is coming in. We wanted to automate the whole stuff coming from the system. We wanted all the seating arrangement that are there, fees who are paid and not paid, everything has to come in the PDF. So we are personally satisfied with PDF because it's all server side PDF that is getting generated. Though we have got client side, but client's machines are 2GB RAM machines. We can't send all the data there and then allow the data table or PhantomJS to generate the PDF. So we rely on huge amount of data to be converted or exported to PDF. So one single click, they wanted the complete institutions, examination, seating arrangement across all the programs for all the batches. So it's too heavy in terms of, you know, client side. So we rely on a server side PDF generation. And PDF kit is very raw in terms of the control that you get in PDF. So you can put where the pagination should come, where the page break to come, what page sizes you want, how you want to orient your text. Something is vertical, something is horizontal, or you can rotate it. Colors and shapes and polygons, everything you are able to achieve it. The last slide, NativeScript and Angular. So we are into NativeScript last 2 months and 2.5 months. So it is nothing but a completely, because there was React Native that is there, you've got Xamarin and other framework. But we don't want to, after learning AngularJS, we don't want to learn another framework on JavaScript. So developer felt that NativeScript and Angular works well. So we did a POC and it's all fine. Now it's into production. So NativeScript and Angular is very well. So it's all HTML, CSS. It gets converted into the corresponding native code, and then, but only drawback is the size of the file, the APKs and other things, minimum it's 35 MB or 40 MB up, only that. So if you're building a very small apps, very pinpointed app, it's fine to go with a native application building. But when it comes to a really enterprise application where you have got multiple modules and you want to scale it up, I think you can't have a development cost which is kind of recurring on every platform and a different frameworks. So your web code, your mobile code running on same single technology and learning on same stuff, it's been amazing to be there with JavaScript. So thank you all. It's all shared. You can, in the interest of time, if you have any doubts, you please write to me. I'll definitely respond. And so it's pleasure to be part of Hasgeek and then present in front of you. Yeah, thank you.